Trigger warning. Please be advised that Locked and Loaded Diaries talks about themes of suicide, homicide, sexual assault, and other wrongful deaths. I'm willing to bet that you think most military deaths happen in the combat zone. Think again. Nearly three quarters of all active duty U.S. military deaths between 2006 and 2020 occurred not in the war theater of Iraq or Syria or Afghanistan, but in places of no conflict. And of that 74%, 93% of deaths happened here on U.S. soil. My name is Kimberly Walker, and I'm an Army combat veteran. These statistics sent me on a goose chase about what was happening in the military and how did these soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines actually die? What did the military know about these deaths, and what were they telling these Gold Star families? Well, I went straight to the source. They have done all the legwork. Please join me and my battle buddies and Gold Star mothers, Terry Caserta and Heather Hedge Baker, where on every episode we will talk to a Gold Star family member and find out what happened to their service member versus what the military told them and the justice that they've never received. Are you ready? Well, we are. Welcome to Locked and Loaded Diaries.
Okay.
Well, hello, listeners. I'm Heather Baker. I'm the mother of Caleb Smither. We have Terry Caserta. And today our guest is Tonya Ogrefe-Neal.
You did good. Good job.
Thank you. I practiced.
Welcome to Locked and Loaded Diaries.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me. It's such an honor.
We've known each other for quite some time. I've known you ever since Fort Hood, our first protest.
Yeah, together. That was going well. July will be 3 years. Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
It's hard. It takes my
breath away.
I know, because it seems like, you know, you deal with this. It seems like it just happened yesterday or like a few months ago. But then when you stop and you look at the calendar and you're like, oh my gosh, it's really been, you know, 2 years or two and a half, or, you know, September, it'll be three.
Yeah.
Mason. And you're just like, where did the time go? You know, and my family kind of laughs. I mean, they don't laugh at me, but like, I swear, the last like 2 years, I've lost 2 years of my life since he's been gone, because I just, it's almost like time froze, you know, and your mind, your heart and everything stops at that moment, but everybody else around you keeps going. And we were just happened to be talking about how long I've lived in my house, and I was 2 years behind. My oldest daughter's like, no, we've lived here like 23 years. And in my mind, I'm like, no, it's only been 21, you know, just because. And then that's when it hit me. Cause I was like, oh my gosh, I just lost 2 years of my life, you know, because like I said, it's just like time stops.
Yeah.
But
lost track of time. I've been thinking about that a lot. Like, I can't believe that we're like, it's been 2 years for us, and we're just starting our third year of this nightmare.
Yeah.
And then I'm thinking about Mason, your son, specialist.
Specialist. Mason. Yes.
Webber.
Yes. My
what
baby.
What a handsome dude he is.
Gosh, he was, but just as handsome as yours. I mean, I look at pictures of him. I'm like, oh my gosh, I did good. I did good with him. He was a handsome boy, you know? And
oh yeah.
He was well known for his smile. You know, he was a turd grown up, like any, you know, teenager, especially, but
the endearing turd.
Yeah.
God bless them. And, you know,
the funny thing is, like, after, you know, and I never met any of his friends, because when he went in like March of, I want to say 2018, and okay. Then he came, I'm trying to think, all I know is he had not been home for like a year before he died. So like, I think he came home after AIT, he was able to come home for like, you know, he surprised me. His older sister and brother like were able to meet him and see him graduate. So then they showed up and surprised me with him coming home. And I want to say that was probably like July of 2018. And so, yeah, it had been like over a year since he'd been home, you know, since we had seen him. And, you know, I never wanted him to go in the Army, you know. Actually, he wanted to be a Marine because we come from a family of Marines. But he regulation had a tattoo that wasn't, you know.
Yeah, here they're a little more strict and about yeah. that in the Marines.
Yeah, he had a tattoo when his grandma on his dad's side died, and it like went below the elbow. So they're like, oh no, you can't join the Marine. Yeah. Now I am he was, you know. It's always the hindsight of, oh, you wish this or you wish that, you know, but yeah, so he, I don't want to say he settled for the Army. He really needed direction. He needed, you know, a place to like go. So I just remember when he told me, I was like, Mason, come on, you know, cause growing up when they were, you know, little boys, I was always like, just don't join the service, please. Just, you know, don't break your mama's heart.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. And, when he told me, I was like, okay, you know, you're an adult, I can't stop you. You know, I'll support you. And he scored like a 98 out of 100 or something. It was like one of the highest scores for the ASFAB. And, he could wow. choose. Yeah. He was a smart cookie. He didn't want people to know he was smart, you know, because then they would expect more of him. And you know, he was cool just being like laid back, chill dude, you know, life of the party. Mm-hmm. So, but they told him, they're like, you can choose anything. You know, you have the pick, you passed, pick whatever. And he's like, well, Mom, I think I want to do infantry. And I'm like, son, come on, you know, you're making your mama like her heart pound. And so I said, please just pick something safe where I don't have to worry about you. Mm-hmm. And he was kind of, you know, into tinkering, and he could build stuff, take things apart. So I mean, mechanic was mm-hmm. just a pretty easy choice for him. So that's what he ended up picking, but he was still part of infantry, mind you. So I thought, okay, you know, you'll be safe. You won't have to go out, hopefully, in the field if, you know, God forbid there's like a war, you know. And I'm like, no worries, you'll be fine, you know. So I was so proud of him, you know.
Yeah.
Just, I mean, because the change in him from, you know, he basically would not, last year of high, he graduated early, but I think they were from high school. I think they were just trying to get rid of him, you know, because he would go to school, you know. He was just like, I don't want to get up, Mom, you know. He'd stay up all night, sleep all day. And so they did what they could. They worked with him. He graduated early. He was like, oh, I'm in such a hurry to move out. So he like wasn't even 18 yet, and he moved in with one of his friends. You know, he couldn't wait to like go out in the world, you know. So yeah, seeing the change of him when I went to go see him graduate basic training was just amazing. You know, he was just, he stood taller, you know, mm-hmm. he was so proud of himself. Yeah. And seeing the change in him, you know, and when we went out for family day, you know, people were saying, thank you for your service. And they were holding doors open, you know, and shaking his hand. And he's like, Mom, he goes, why are they thanking me? I haven't done anything. And I'm like, dude, you know how many people would not have done what you've done, sign up, you know, sign the dotted line, give your life to this, the government, the big entity, and say, you know, there's so many people out there who would be like, I'm not, you know, I'm like, you know how brave that was of you to do that, you know? And, but yeah, he was just like floored. He's like, why are people? And I'm like, they have respect, because not a lot of people these days, you know, think about doing that. So, I mean, it was just awesome seeing, you know, how proud he was. And
oh yeah,
you know, I was a proud mama too. So, excuse me, get dry mouth.
Maybe. And we are.
Yeah.
There's yeah. so much that you're saying that reminds me of Caleb.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I could pick it apart, but it's beautiful. I'm getting a really beautiful picture of your boy. It's just what a precious young man.
He was just, you know, it was really funny when, you know, I never met anybody from Texas until we had to fly down for the service. And I knew, you know, all of his friends up here that he grew up with. So flying down there after he passed and hearing all his friends down there say the exact same thing about my son that his friends up here would say about him. I know, it just affirmed to me that, wow, this, he was so well loved. And yeah. he, like, they said the same thing down there, you know, he would just go out of his way to make somebody feel better, you know, if they were down, depressed, would stop whatever he was doing and just like lift him up. You know, he didn't want to see anybody sad. He didn't want to see anybody hurting. He had lots of girls as friends. And so he would like protect them like no other. And so it was heartwarming to hear that people here, his friends here, and then his friends down there had the exact same thing to say about him, how he always had that wide ass grin, you know, cheek ear to ear about, you know, always that smile on his face. And you know, the life of the party, he just wanted to live life. He just wanted to enjoy every moment, you know. So yeah, he was amazing. He was an amazing person. He's, you know, and he still is, you know, in spirit. He's of course. Yeah, so, yeah. And yeah, he's very, very dearly. So
he was a Bradley mechanic.
He was a Bradley mechanic he ended up choosing, yes. And I just remember, you know, messages from him and, you know, short little Snapchats that he was always being moved from unit to unit. Like, he'd be part of Bravo and then Charlie was fighting for him, and I don't know, is it like Delta? I don't know. Ooh. But he was just always like, yeah, he was just, I'm moving to this unit and I'm moving to that one. And of course, you know, as a mom, over my head, I'm like, I don't know what you're talking about, but where are you going? You know what I mean? Where are you going to be now? Who? And no, Mom, don't worry. He's like, I'm staying here. I'm just switching units, because he was like one of the top mechanics. So they were all kind of like fighting for him.
Wow. That's so awesome.
Yeah. So, I, you know, honestly, off the top of my head, I don't remember which company he got switched to before he died. But yeah, he was good at what he did, you know. And so I just remember that I got a message from him probably like around noonish on September 5th. And he just said, you know, I asked him how he was doing, and he's like, yeah, I'm fine, Mom. I'm just really, really tired. And I'm like, oh, you know, why? And he was like, well, you know, they had me up till like midnight, 1 a.m. working, because they were trying to get ready for deployment. They were set to deploy like in a couple weeks. And so they were trying to, you know how people scramble to get everything done, you know, before they have to move. So they had them working late, and then they wanted them back like within 3 to 5 hours the next morning for, you know, to start working the next day. And I was told that, you know, I get conflicting stories from different people. You know, the report, the 15-6 is so redacted. And of course, they make them look good. And, you know, everybody else, you know, it's just all hearsay. But I was told that there has to be a certain amount of time between shifts for them to be able to work mechanically on something. And so they didn't have him per se working on Bradley's. They had him packing up an office, you know, kind of like a light duty thing, just because they had kept him so late and they wanted him back early. So he was packing up like, I don't know, colonel's or somebody's office. And this Bradley that had been sitting in the motor pool for like ever, and all the reports on it, I guess it didn't have accurate reports on it. They had to get it moved out of the motor pool for deployment, because I guess they take these, all of the Bradleys, no matter working or not working, and they deploy with the soldiers, which I thought was kind of odd. But because this Bradley, specific Bradley, had been sitting there not working for like months. And so they were basically they had to get it out of the motor pool for deployment, and the records weren't accurate. They weren't up to date. It wasn't a regular crew that had been familiar with the Bradley. It was just a bunch of guys they threw together with an NCO who was not familiar with the issues with this Bradley either. Because I know in the 15-6, they, you know, everything I kept reading was, you know, everybody was pushing blame on somebody else. Well, this person just came on and took over, and they weren't aware of like the records, or they weren't accurate and they weren't up to date. And it was just like, nobody was taking accountability for anything pertaining to this specific Bradley that ended up killing my son. So like I said, there wasn't a crew that was familiar. They didn't have the accurate records to look at. Basically, the hydraulic system on the tank, the engine compartment lid, was broke. And so there's a tanker bar, I guess, that kind of holds it up in place. But they couldn't move the Bradley without shutting the lid, because, you know, it was blocking the view for whoever was going to drive it out of the motor pool. And so the issue was, they couldn't close it. They couldn't figure out why it wasn't closing. And so Mason was not working on this. Like I said, he was packing an office, but he happened to walk by, and the NCO that was in charge, can I say his name? Because the case is closed. He was NCO Wilder was his name. Sergeant Wilder. He this was before Mason came on, you know, walked by or whatever. He ordered the crew that was there, to hook the engine, because they lift the lids with a crane normally, and they have a hook that is specifically used to hold, you know, the weight of the lid up. But because they were deploying, they had packed up a lot of stuff, and so they didn't have the correct lifting crane hook because it was packed away. And so a lot, you know, some of the soldiers that were there were saying, you know, this isn't going to work. I will, one of them, and it even said in the report, I will go find one. I will go look for one, because the NCO wanted them to use a strap to hold it up instead of the correct metal hook. And the NCO Wilder was like, no, he goes, we don't have time. We need to get this out of here. Let's just, he basically pulled rank and said, we're using the fucking strap. Just hook it up. Let's go. And so another soldier left, actually, and went to find the colonel, who was in his office on his phone. He playing a game, is what I was told. This was like an eyewitness who was there. I don't think it was in the 15-6, but he told me that the colonel was playing Candy Crush or something on his phone, or was doing something on his phone. And the soldier walked up and told him, this NCO wants us to use a strap to, you know, attach this compartment panel lid instead of the hook, the correct hook. And he's like, I told him I would go find one, but he said, no, use the strap. And this soldier told me, the colonel looked up from his phone, said, yeah, don't do that. And then he went right back to what he was doing. Didn't bother to stop what he was doing, get up, go see, you know, what this NCO was doing, or correct what was, you know, whatever he was trying to do, correct him and say, hey, look, this, you know, he didn't bother to investigate. He didn't bother to go check it out. Just like brushed off this soldier and said, yeah, just tell him no. Like, you know, an NCO is going to listen to, you know, a PFC or below. And so, you know, they had the crane hooked up with a strap, trying to hold the engine lit up. Mind you, the tanker bar was in place, which is like, I think like a brace that was holding it up to begin with. And so Mason, that was when Mason walked by and was like, hey, you know, guys, what's going on? You know, what's happening? And NCO Wilder was like, well, you know, we can't figure out why this isn't closing. You want to take a look at it? So I'm guessing, you know, Mason was going on a few hours of sleep. I'm speculating. He did not stop to look and see how, because the engine panel lid was already in the upright position. And I'm guessing he didn't think to look how it was connected. But do you know that my CAC officer, my casualty assistance officer, had the guts to tell me, because I asked questions during this whole investigation. You know, I'm the type of person, I try to understand, you know, how things happen, or you know, step by step, what happened to lead up to this thing. I'm just that type of person. And so when I would ask him questions, he would just shake his head at me and treat me like I was a stupid woman who was asking silly questions, you know. And he looked at me and he said, well, what if it was your son's fault for not seeing how the engine compartment lid was being held up? And I was like, so taken aback, you know. I'm like, you're seriously going to try to blame my son for his own death? You know, I was like,
oh my gosh.
I was just like, and I was so pissed, like beyond pissed, you know. And you probably noticed, like, you go into mama bear mode and you're like, you know, it, how do you blame my son who is a baby? And there's the NCO that was in charge that day was only 3 years older than my son. So in my mind, they're babies leading babies, you know. I don't feel like, and I know things in the Army work different in the military, you know, they give people as young as 23, 24, 25 NCOs in whatever position.
But with leadership that's playing Candy Crush.
Right. Yes. I'm like, why? And I, you know, and I would ask questions like that. I'd be like, okay, tell me how in the military, like say in the private sector, I was like, okay, so you have a supervisor, which would be in my mind, an NCO. You have a supervisor who is not doing what they're supposed to be doing. Shouldn't the manager be responsible for what the supervisor is doing? And once again, I was treated like I was, you silly girl. That's not how it works in the military. You know, we have different ranks and they're in charge of this and this and this. And that's just the way it works. And I'm like, my mind is like, that's fucked up. You know, I'm like, how you have a 25-year-old making stupid decisions and there's nobody in, you know, responsible for him. That to me, I'm just like, that doesn't and make sense.
Not to interrupt you, but there's no way Mason would have looked up. Why? Because he trusted his fellow soldiers
and his leaders.
They were doing the right thing. So why would he? He trusted them.
Yeah. And that was, you know, and that was something I pointed out to him. I was like, well, you know, if things were being followed the way they were supposed to be, he wouldn't have had to question.
Correct.
He wouldn't have be like, oh, let me stop and think, you know, is that hooked up the correct? And plus, you know, going on a few hours of sleep, you don't think clearly, you know, and that's why they didn't have him working mechanically on something. They had him packing an office. And I mean, there was just so much to his story that was wrong. And every time I tried to ask questions or bring up something, you know, like I said, I was immediately, it was squashed, you know, it was, oh, you're being unrealistic. You know, this is just the good old boy military. That's how it works.
It was squashed by the casualty assistance officer.
He was one of them, but because he would, you know, that's who you talk to about.
Yeah.
What's going on before you get the 15-6, you're really not allowed to talk to anybody else. You have to, you probably know, you go through them if you have questions or they find out the information for you, you know, they act like they're helping you, but they're really, I know you had, from what I've heard, you had a wonderful casualty assistance officer.
Yeah, but see, the thing is that we've all been treated differently. I think about Terry and Patrick in Brandon's case and how his belongings were handled and how our belongings were handled. I don't know about Mason's. But just the different, you know, everything's.
Well, since my son was married for 6 months before he died, I only got what she allowed me to have.
Yeah.
So I really don't know what, you know, as far as that goes.
Yeah. Everyone's situation is so different.
It is.
Yeah. Yeah. I just remember, you know, and it wasn't like I liked him at first, you know, he was a good support for me, but I just kind of felt the more questions I asked, the more I felt like I was being a pain in his ass, you know, and he was just like, I was an annoying little gnat that he was just trying to get through and deal with and just be done, you know.
He probably,
I just felt like I was, I don't know. I don't want to say I felt like I was meant to sound crazy, but I was just like questioning myself for the questions I had, knowing that it wasn't adding up, but I was made to feel stupid. And I don't know, and nothing against this guy. He was a lifer military, you know, and it was probably ingrained in him that, you know, the military does no wrong, you know, this is the way it goes, yada, yada, yada. And he was just ready to retire. He was like a master sergeant or something like that. I mean, he was pretty high up there. He basically led the Camp Dodge, which is the base here in Iowa where all the processing goes through for like people entering. And that's who they assigned to me. So, I mean, he was good at what he did, but he was very pro-Army, I feel. So, yeah, I just didn't like the way I was made to feel stupid for having questions, you know, because and at one point he did tell me my son's death was messed up. It was a huge mistake. You know, it shouldn't have happened. But then it was almost like he was backpedaling, saying, you know, this happens, you know, things like this happen in the military.
But see, I think sometimes when it's a big situation happening, they put somebody in there to squash it.
Yes. And
you know, manipulate the situation a bit.
And so, I mean, I guess we could go back to, you know, basically what happened to my son was when he went to under the hood, like the NCO asked him, he also asked a soldier to release the tanker bar, which was what was holding the engine lid up. And I don't know why he would ask this soldier to do it while my son was under there. To me, I'm like, wouldn't that be something you would do without somebody underneath it, knowing that you had a strap holding it up that was not weighted to hold that much? You know, apparently each
sounds
strap
sounds like premeditated murder to me.
Well, I know. I've had people say that to me too, like, what if it wasn't an accident? And I'm like, how do I prove that? You know, how do I prove it, you know? So my son was underneath and the soldier released the tanker bar, the hydraulic system was broke. So, you know, it comes crashing down, the strap couldn't hold it up. The crane, the correct hook probably would have held it up, but not the strap. And so it came crashing down on my son and, he was trapped in between the lid and, you know, the engine. And it took several people, you know, to lift it up off of him. And I remember reading the report and it said that Specialist Mason Webber slumped to the ground in a pool of his own blood. And I remember I didn't know that was what happened exactly until I read the report. Oh, I'm sorry. Until I read the report myself. And I remember standing at my kitchen island reading that. And, you know, I gasped and I dropped the book out of my hand. Like I couldn't believe that I was reading that about my son and that. I couldn't believe that it really happened. And to know that it was preventable,
is just so heartbreaking. It's just, I try not to think about it. I try not to dwell, you know, I take a step back from being so outspoken about it, just because telling it over and over and over again, it just gets to be too much, you know, and I didn't want to be stuck, and I didn't want those words to like keep replaying over and over in my head, that my son's last moments were him slumping to the ground with his head crushed. And I just, I think about, was he in pain? Did he know? What was he aware of what was going on, you know? And I wasn't there, you know, to make sure my baby was okay. And it's just too much, you know. This is really like the first time I've talked about it in a long time, because I try not to dwell on how he died, you know. I want to talk about the person he is, or the person he was, and I want people to remember him for that and not for the way he died,
right?
You know, so I'm sorry, this is, I like I said, I really have not openly talked about this, you know, for long time.
And well, we have to bite the bullet in order to hold people accountable, and that's a very hard thing to do, and you had to do that, bite the bullet, and you did it very well, and you have, and I know you continue to, but it's just, it's such an over, it's such a overwhelming feeling.
It is.
To be covered in such a way, like, it feels to me like, you know, like an atomic bomb just goes off. And then when you have no answers, and you then you see the negligence, and you experience the disrespect from these, you know, leadership, the supposed leadership directed towards you, the family member, the innocent party. Like, it's unbelievably hurtful, and it drags you through your heart through the mud, your mind through the mud, and then what you've gone through on top of all of that privately and everything else, you know, what happens to your family, the fact that he, you know, was married, all of those things, you know, and, you know, everything that goes along with that.
Yeah.
It's just, oh, it's too much. And so I'm so grateful that you were able to come on here today, because this is a platform and an opportunity to just say it.
Yeah.
It's there, and you can direct people to it. Like, here's the story. You want to hear about it? Here it is.
And yeah. You don't have to keep telling it over and over and over.
So,
well, it's, I know that, you know, I remember when they flew my son home, we opened it up to the media to show up, you know, to tell his story, to, nobody showed up, not a single news station showed up. And in fact, I had to reach out to several local news channels and say, hey, because all they did was release my son's name and in his picture. And I was like, I don't want him, like I said, I don't want him to be remembered that way. And it, I almost got the feeling like they didn't want his story out, because they knew they were at fault. And part of the report, what was so confusing, was that they said it was negligence. They it says it in writing that it was negligence, but it was part of the I forget what part of the, it wasn't part of the 15-6. So
they maintenance accident.
It was an unfortunate mishap is what I was told.
Say again?
An unfortunate mishap. I'm like, okay, but.
Oh, wow. That puts a label on it, doesn't it?
Yeah,
it was such a mishap. How disrespectful of them to say that. It's almost like, I'm sorry for your loss. Yeah. I think it's disrespectful when you have such, when you have such negligence involved for the command to only say, I'm sorry for your loss.
Yeah, it was made better.
Let's go a little further here, guys. Sorry for what?
At least you got that.
Yeah. No kidding.
The fake letters of, oh, we are so sorry. He was such a valuable, you know. And
yeah, blah, blah.
Yeah, I know. When we flew out there to, you know, for the unit memorial, we asked to speak to his commanders, and you know, they stood up in front of all of us one by one, and they gave their fake condolences, all but one who was very sincere, and he teared up talking about my son. But we wanted questions. We had questions for them, and we were told that we were going to get to meet with them after the funeral or the service. And we waited and waited and waited. And then like 30 minutes later, we were told they had to go to a like last minute emergency meeting.
Of course they did. Respectful.
Yeah. And so I just remember staring at his colonel, the one that was in charge. And I just remember glaring at him through the whole service, and he would not look my way at all. Cause he knew he was guilty. He knew he was responsible. And of course, you know, they don't,
they're just cowards.
Yeah, they are. And they don't let
we're just family... little lady.
Oh, I know. Don't know anything, but I do know he got to retire with full benefits. That was his punishment. He was forced out of the army. As far as the NCO, I don't know what happened to him, but I think he got discharged as well. But no jail time, no nothing. It was not punishable in their eyes of, you know, taking my son's life was basically a slap on the wrist.
It was an accident.
It was a mishap. So it's a tough pill to swallow, you know. And I've tried to get his story out there, and it just seems like nobody wants to talk about it. You know, it's just and I remember like just like a week ago or a couple weeks ago, I was watching the Today Show, which I don't watch the news, and I just happened to have it on. And there was a mom on there talking about her Navy SEAL son who had just finished Hell Week, and he died. And it kind of reminded me of your story, Heather, with Caleb. He died of some unforeseen illness, but it was, I think it had something to do with the leadership not paying attention to his symptoms or whatever was going on with him.
He had sepsis.
Was that what it was? And I was just like, I was furious. My oldest daughter was in the room with me, and I was like, how the hell can she get her story out there when your brother died due to complete negligence of a leader, and we can't even get anybody to pick up that story?
And what you just said is why.
Yeah.
It's because it was a leader, and they are not going to expose any story that proves and shows that a leader was at fault.
Right. Exactly. Then they know it. And they, like I said, from the beginning, it's like they just wanted to squash Mason's story. They don't want it out there. And, you know, I was very, very outspoken in the beginning, but it just kind of, like I said, it gets to be too much and you got to step away for a while. And I'm not saying I won't regroup and I won't, you know, get back out there and be outspoken. But, you know, like I said, I have two new grandbabies that, you know, are taking up my, I know, it's so exciting. So, I mean, I'm just surrounded. Yeah, I'm surrounded by love and blessings and focus. But I just admire both of you and the strength and the determination you have to like just keep pushing on. I admire you guys. I do. You know, people look at me all the time and they're like, "You're so strong," and I'm like, "I don't feel it." You know, I just. It's tough to be a part of this group, as you guys all know.
Yeah. And we come in and out and we, when we're ready and we, and it's, it's okay. That's how it is.
It's gonna be like, yeah. It's a lifelong journey.
Yeah.
You know,
and slack. You know what you could do? This is just a suggestion. You could write out Mason's story.
Mm-hmm.
And pay newspapers to run it as an an opine. Yeah,
that's a great idea.
That's the first.
Why don't we all start doing that?
What's it called? An opine?
Yeah, they call it an opine. It's a like an opinion page, like an opinion piece. And if you find out how much a newspaper would, how much it is to get it printed, and you're willing to pay whatever that is, they'll print it for you.
Oh, yeah, I'll have to look into that for
sure. Just whenever. It's just a thought.
No, that, thank you for that information, because like I said, there, I have thoughts where, you know, I'm ready to fight and I want to get out there, but you don't know where to start because you've tried this and you've tried that. And I've tried, you know, our senators here in Iowa and nothing ever came of it, you know, and it's just like, you just feel helpless. So, yeah. I mean, I welcome any.
I'm laughing about the senators in Iowa because I'm from Iowa too.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
None of them cared about the Brandon Act. Now, we did meet with Joni Ernst's staff in 2019. They sat with us, spur of the moment. They spent 30 minutes with us, never heard back from them at all.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I didn't either. I think I got the you know, fake, oh, yes, we will take this into consideration, blah, blah, blah letter.
We'll let her know.
Chuck Grassley was one I did not hear back from.
Yeah, me neither.
Was the whole fake, oh yes, we are saddened to hear this. We will look into it. We will check into it. Blah, blah, blah. You know, I'm just like, whatever, you know.
Nancy Grace. Sounds like my experience with Nancy Grace.
Oh, how, what happened over there? I don't know.
Come here. Let me let you meet this lady here. Let me pass you off to this lady. Get her name and number. Never call her again. Block her. No. I don't know if that's what they did, but they never called me. They certainly never called me.
It's just sick of
me out of the way.
Yeah. That's how you feel. I mean, that's how you feel whenever.
It made me feel like I'm peddling a story and it's not a story. Yeah.
Right. It's happened. It's
something happening that's pretty monumental to our nation.
Right. And I mean, and I'm sure there's hundreds of stories just like my son's and like yours.
We got to find all these families. I've had three so far this week contact me, which I'm so grateful for. I'm like, where's everybody? Come on. Let's huddle it up. Let's come together now. You know,
and
Tonya, need to see the numbers.
I'm going to tell you something that I told Heather not too long ago. Whenever you see an article that can be related to Mason's story, immediately contact that reporter. Tell them your story. It doesn't mean they're going to take it, but you need to get it out there.
Well, you know, I had saw Heather, I had saw your article. I haven't read it yet, but it was for Task and Purpose. Yes. And I remember I got interviewed for that and it never went anywhere.
Really?
To my knowledge, it did not get published. It was Rose. Was it Rose?
This is a different journalist, but.
Oh yeah. I think that was the name who was with me, who interviewed me.
Happened to me a number of times with other people.
Yeah. So, and it's like, why?
It's like, what am I, chop liver?
Yeah.
Like, what is Caleb chop liver, you know?
Yeah. Why answer my questions? Why seek me out and then not publish it, you know? And I'm just like, it's frustrating because, you know, you guys all know how it is. You want it to not happen to another family. You want it to not.
Exactly. It's not about like
fame and fortune.
Yeah. See, here's what happened to me recently. Our local news here, I was trying to explain what recent events are happening in Caleb's case to this reporter. And she's like, well, I mean, you know, basically we're not going to cover, we've already covered his story before, you know? Okay. Well, mm-hmm. You covered it. Now there's some updates, you know? And then she just like looks past me. It's just like, it's so disrespectful. I'm like, here we are in Caleb's own city. Like she's telling me that I should go to a bigger news platform, you know? And I'm like, I've tried, they won't even respond to me. Mm-hmm. Not even my senators will respond to me. What are you supposed to do? I'm trying to, if even the local people around don't even care.
Yeah.
You want me to bring it to the nation if you guys aren't going to even try to help, you know? So
I guess what we need to do is inundate everybody with everybody's story just to prove that we are not the only stories out there that are seeking, I'll say, attention. There's hundreds and thousands of us out there.
Right.
And if that's what it takes, I'm willing to do whatever and try to get everybody else on board.
Well, that's kind of what this platform is about, is all of us coming together for us to have one platform where we can share everyone's situation so that people can see the numbers.
That they're not alone, that there's people that can relate to each of our stories. You know, to Caleb's and to Brandon's and to Mason's and
they're new ones.
Yeah.
Yeah. Within 7 months and 6 months and 5 months and 4 months that are calling. I've gotten phone calls the last couple of days.
Ow.
It's horrifying.
It is. I mean, the lack of care for soldiers is heartbreaking, you know.
It's the barometer for the state of our nation. How we treat our service members is how the state of our nation. I mean, how we're running our you know, we're allowing these toxic cultures to
rise.
Yeah. I used to have such respect for the military, you know, until, you know, definitely what happened to my son. That was a big eye opener. And then, you know, meeting you, Heather, and then hearing about Brandon's story, it's just like, until it personally affects you, you don't understand it and you don't realize it's going on, you know? And of course you pay attention and then you see these other stories and you're like, why is this happening? You know, you would think that the military would have higher standards, especially, you know. And I remember asking my CAC officer, I was like, you know, why OSHA is responsible for safety of things in the workplace. Why is the military not held?
What's holding you guys accountable?
Exactly. And he just was,
no one, ourselves.
Yeah. I got the same head. I got the same shaking his head going, this doesn't work like that.
It's stupid supposed lady. To.
I know.
Congress is overall, and they just leave it to the secretaries of their respective branch, and they're failing not only our service members, but they're failing their parents and families. Right. This affects everybody in the family, not just the service member, right. not just their spouse or their parents. It affects everybody. And then, you know, once these stories start coming out, other nations are going to say, what's going on with America's military?
Yeah.
Now's the time to hit them up because they aren't doing well in the armed forces.
It's a free for all on every base.
Yeah, they're killing their own soldiers.
Yep. Yep. You know,
every ship.
It's sad.
It's uncalled for, and it's got to stop. It has to stop.
I agree. So yeah, thank you for letting me come and speak about Mason.
We love Mason so much.
Thank you.
I tell you what a blessing it was to just get a chance to meet you in person.
Yeah.
It was so fulfilling to me. I know. I can't wait to meet Terry in person. So one of these days we'll
I know.
Meet.
We'll get there.
It's just like, to me, like even just getting to see you across the internet here, what a blessing it is.
Yeah, I've kind of been in hiding. Yeah. I know I've kind of just pulled back, you know, like I said, and
but you've been focusing on the good stuff too. You have to recharge yourself.
Yeah.
And you know, if it's supposed to happen, if you're supposed to jump back in there and you know, do anything, then you'll know when the time will be right. Meanwhile, we'll have this platform available, and of course, you can come back and talk to us anytime you want.
Absolutely.
You can come in and sit in with us as we interview somebody else if you like to sometimes.
Yeah, that'd be great. I would. Yeah, in fact, I was, you know, it's too bad Kim's not here because I think we need to do like a women's retreat at her place in Arizona.
I agree. In Santa Fe.
She's in New Mexico. Yeah.
Or not Arizona.
I agree. And we need to make that happen.
Yeah. Cause I told her, I was like, I need to come visit you, have like a mental health, you know,
let's time do it. Away. I'm only like 6 hours away. Terry's only I don't know. I think you're about 6 hours. Something.
I don't know. I'm in Arizona. So I don't know.
Yeah.
Arizona. I was getting you two mixed up, but yeah, I'm 5 hours away by plane. So yeah, I would be willing to do it.
And I know you're not a big fan of Texas, but you know, Lubbock, Texas is here for you. I know. Yeah. I remember you saying like, you're like, I don't want to go back to.
Yeah.
To
well, you know, my son, my oldest son, Mason's older brother is like talking about moving there. I'm like, no.
Oh, gosh. So,
like Texas already took one of my babies. I don't need them to take another one, you know?
Yeah, even though. I understand.
Yeah, but I come see your beautiful face. I would come there.
Well, Texas, it has its beautiful parts too.
Yeah, it does. Away from Killeen and Fort Hood. I can't do that.
That was really rough. That was rough.
It was
like so close to when both of our sons had passed away. Caleb had just passed away in January and Mason in September. Before that.
Yeah.
2019.
It was hard. Like,
I think it's amazing how we all found one another too. It's just like that amazes me when I think about it.
Right. No, it was a wonderful experience. And I was glad I got to meet, you know, you and Kim and the rest of the crew that was there. It was a great bonding moment for sure. You know, cause you know, being like in Iowa, we don't have like a military base per se. And so there's there's not a lot of military support here, you know, and you kind of, and I think everybody can relate to, you kind of feel isolated, you know, when you have, you know, your service member die, and reaching out, able to bond and meet other people who know what you're going through really does help. So
your specific brand of pain.
Yes. That's to be a part of, you know, it's like your own little group. So
yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we've got to make it happen, because it's something really special to get to hang out with you. So
no, thank you. So it's, I'm glad to see both of you.
You too.
Even under these circumstances, I'm just, you guys are both beautiful. I love you guys.
Well, I know that our service members are up there leading the way.
Yes.
And
they're giving heaven some hell, right?
I love that. I love the way you
put that. I do too.
Giving heaven some hell.
They'll be there for us. That's right.
Well, so, thank you so much for being here, telling us all about
you.
Beautiful
Mason. We appreciate it. The story is heartbreaking.
It is, but I'm so glad that is out there, like you said, and that people can hear it and see it. So,
yep.
Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you.
Bye.
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 All right.
I'm trying to stop it. Hold on. Where did it go? Oh.
Mr. Sandman.